If we select the second icon, the yellow lightning bolt, the program will carry out an initial analysis as if we'd clicked on the gray lightning bolt. In other words, it will calculate the necessary reinforcements and then show a dialog box that will allow us to choose from the most common rebar diameters. If there are stirrups, these can also be modified. Let's take a look at how this works. We see here that the program first gives us information for the longitudinal reinforcement and for the stirrups, for each type of reinforcement that we've defined. In this example, for the upper reinforcement, we can access this list and see that if we make no changes, the program has defined two bars of 17.86, giving 501 millimeters squared of reinforcement. In the second line, it provides data for the exact value designed, in this case 504 millimeters squared. And in the next section of the list, we'll have, in increasing order, proposed reinforcements with the most common diameters that will be progressively further from the exact steel reinforcement ratio. If, for example, we insert 18 bars of 6, we'll have 509 millimeters squared, which gives us an area very nearly exact, and hence it shall serve our purpose. For the case of R1, it's the same, so we'd include 11 bars of 6 to get 311 millimeters squared, which is a bit higher than the 242, but it is quite close in any case. For the stirrups, also the same. Instead of 374, if we place two bars of 6 at 15 centimeters, we'll get 377 millimeters squared per meter. And for the remaining stirrups, instead of 131, we'll use two bars of 6 at 20 centimeters and two bars of 6 at 10 centimeters down here. If we now apply these modifications, we'll still have information on the required reinforcement, but also for the reinforcement we've placed, which will result in differing steel reinforcement ratios, and likewise for shear reinforcement. We now have the most common diameters. We should bear in mind that upon selecting our reinforcements, the program will execute one final calculation with our most recent configuration, and for reasons like having larger diameters or second layers of reinforcement and so on, it may modify the internal lever arm in comparison with the initial lever arm, and so the maximum efficiency may be exceeded, possibly even by 2%. If this occurs, the program will give us a warning message saying that the safety factor is 1.02, at which point we must simply redo our calculations so everything works as it should. The last thing we need to discuss here is the meaning of this uniaxial bending with respect to axis Y. If this is marked, the program will make the moment in Z zero and the neutral axis will always be horizontal, even for asymmetric cross sections. In other words, for bending and axial force, the forces will only be in balance with the external forces with respect to the horizontal axis Y. It will omit the forces in Z. As for shear and torsion, if we select uniaxial bending, the program eliminates the VY component and the torsional component, such that the VZ balance is considered only in the Z direction and for those shear walls that have this component active.